with all the controversies currently in the gamosphere recently, with Sweet Baby Inc. and all of its cohorts of destruction decimating fun out of gaming with all of their isms. Oh, the tangled web we weave when we complain and moan and ree! Well, the Panda thought it would be better to do something lighthearted to take people's minds off of the propaganda nonsense pushed by some of the most privileged people in the world, the awfuls. So, Panda Gaming Podcast presents the top 10 most badass pandas. Panda number 10. Cute and fluffy Lun Lun. Lun Lun is a female giant panda at Zoo Atlanta in Atlanta. Hold on. Zoo Atlanta in Atlanta? How fucking redundant. Who writes this shit? Anyways, Atlanta, Georgia. The panda, now 242 sexy pounds, was born at the Chengdu Research Base of Giant Panda Breeding in China on August 25th of 1997. Her original name was Hua Hua. Why did they change it then? Who knows? Well, it was changed to Lun Lun by her sponsor, the Taiwanese rock star Su Hulian. Hulian? Su Hulian. Okay, it looks right. Born at the Chengdu Research Base of Giant Panda Breeding in China, she was separated from her mama at 4.5 months of age. She arrived... Oh, well, damn. You didn't give her very much time to wean now, did y'all? She arrived at Zoo Atlanta in Atlanta, redundant, with Yang Yang. Was that a boy? He's playing with his Yang Yang. In 1999, and has gone on to become the mother of 7 offspring. Ooh, she's getting busy.
Oh, say less.
Let's see, hold on. She's got 7 offsprings. Mei Lan, born in 2006. Ji Lan, born in 2008. Poe. Yeah, of course there's going to be a stinking Poe. Born in 2010. Twins. Oh, she gave birth to twins. Mei Lun and Mei Huan. Born in 2013. Man, this girl gets busy for a panda. You know, pandas generally don't want to do any kind of mating. She had twins again. Look at that. Ya Lun and Zi Lun. Born September 3rd, 2016. Lun Lun is considered to be a strikingly beautiful panda because her cheeks are very round and fluffy, and apparently the Chinese people think that a round face is really pretty. So, there's that. Panda number 9. Panda in Tekken. Panda. She's a character in Tekken, the fighting game series. She's a giant panda and the loyal pet, best friend, and bodyguard of Ling Xiaoyu. Panda, she made her debut in Tekken 3 and has returned for every mainline game since. I think it's up to Tekken 8 now. Panda, well, she was originally just a palette swap for Kuma 2 until finally receiving her own character slot since Tekken Tag Tournament 2. However, she had her own character slot for the very first time in Tekken Card Challenge. Seriously? Tekken Card Challenge? There's a Tekken Card Challenge. Wow, talk about the nerdiest of nerd games. Panda uses Kuma Shinken, the same fighting style as Kuma 2. Starting in Tekken 8, Panda inherits attacks from Lin Xiaoyu, which only makes total sense because supposedly Panda's been the bodyguard of Lin Xiaoyu since Tekken Tag Tournament. Panda number 8. Meisheng. Meisheng, Chinese for beautiful life or born in the USA. Hold on. Beautiful life or born in the USA? How do you get those two distinctions? Well, I guess if you've lived under Chinese communism for any amount of time, being born in the USA is a beautiful life. I digress. Okay. Meisheng, born in August 19, 2003, is a male giant panda born at the San Diego Zoo. He's the second panda to be born at the zoo. Meisheng was sent to China on November 5th, 2007. He was reported to have arrived safely at the Wulong National Reserve, the Wulong National Nature Reserve on November 8, 2007. After the 2008 Sichuan earthquake, Meisheng was relocated to the Baifengzi Panda Base just outside of Yan'an, where in May of 2009 he successfully got busy with a female giant panda named Ying Ying. Panda number 7. Po. Po from Kung Fu Panda. Y'all know this guy. Overweight, clumsy panda, foster child of a noodle-slinging goose. Never understood the whole goose thing. I seen the origin story, but whatever. It was either by mistake or fate or whichever. Po was chosen by the wise men of the valley, Master Oogway the Turtle. As prophesied as the dragon warrior, he would become the protector of the valley. I think it was Rabbit Valley. I'm not real familiar with the lore. Along with his master, a red panda. Red panda. Master Shifu, Dustin Hoffman, props. His tag team cohorts, the Furious Five, had adventures in martial arts that span over 4 movies, one currently coming out, several miniseries on streaming services, and a multi-season TV show on a children's cable network. Outside his bumbling, Po, always with comedy and the help of his friends, learned a lesson that he uses to progress. Who wrote this? Into becoming a better panda and a dragon warrior. Now, my take on it, I've seen it. The first one was really good. The second one was okay. And then, like, you know, after that, it's like jumping the shark, if you know the expression. And I kind of lost my affinity for the series itself. But that's just me and this one panda's take on it. Panda number 6. Red Panda, Master Shifu. Master Shifu was the student of the late Master Oogway and a trainer to all of the greatest warriors in China, including Po. And the Furious Five. So what this is trying to tell me is that all of China's greatest warriors were trained under either Master Oogway or Master Shifu. Well, anyways, he's also the adoptive father of Tigress and Tai Lung. Now, I knew he was the adoptive father of Tai Lung because he messed that one up pretty bad with all of his daddy issues that he had. But I didn't realize that he also had adopted Tigress. See, I'm not familiar with the lore. Master Shifu was seen as a loving father and devoted teacher to a young Tai Lung when the cub first appeared. But after he had to give Tai Lung up, he became distant, a firm and harsh taskmaster, and somewhat insensitive. Well, let's put the brakes on that for a second and rewind it. Because you'd become a harsh taskmaster that's firm and somewhat insensitive if your favorite student and the one you love decided to go on a killing spree and a rampage and you had to whoop his ass and put him in prison. But I digress. So, apparently he's also quite sarcastic, our red panda, Master Shifu. He's sarcastic, he's got a devious sense of humor, which is particularly shown when he takes every opportunity to make Po suffer. It wasn't until Po saved Master Shifu's life and brought the old master to peace that he let go of the past and opened up to his students. He is seen just like Po and all of the Kung Fu Panda movies. I think there's 4. There's one that's coming out. Talked about it just a minute ago. All of the streaming miniseries and the television shows. He's the one character that continued to maintain through all of the series and shows and miniseries, just like Po. I don't believe the Furious Five are in any of the miniseries or TV shows, just the movies, and I don't even believe that they're in this latest movie, Kung Fu Panda 4. We'll see. I don't know if I'll go see that one or not. This panda is not too impressed with Kung Fu Panda. Like I said, I feel like they jumped the shark around season two. Panda number five! Rocket Raccoon, Trash Panda. Rocket Raccoon, also known as Subject 89P13, is a raccoon that was genetically and cybernetically modified by the weirdo, the High Evolutionary, giving him enhanced intelligence, the ability to speak. He named himself Rocket. He befriended a fellow half-worlders. He was imprisoned with Layla, Tiefs, and Floor. Oh, those names are so damn creative. With the four believing that they would soon be allowed to live in peace on a new planet that the High Evolutionary was making. While aiding the High Evolutionary and perfecting his experiments, Rocket discovered that he and his little weirdo friends were slated to be killed. Now Rocket attempted to free his friends only for the High Evolutionary to kill Layla. I think that was like the rabbit one. No, I don't know. Maybe she was an otter, I think. Rocket then attacked his former master, mutilating him, which inadvertently caused the death of the little rabbit and the big-ass walrus, Teef and Floor. I got the names reversed from what I said before, but whatever. Afterwards, Rocket, got out of there. He booked it and jumped on a ship, fled into the cosmos. After spanning years of adventuring and making new friends and creating a new family with the Guardians, everybody's seen all the movies and somebody read the comics, I think. Well, upon learning that he was a raccoon, he dubbed himself Rocket Raccoon. It wasn't really until the whole High Evolutionary thing that he decided to call himself Rocket Raccoon, at least as far as the movie canon goes, I think. That's when he joined his fellow Guardians in a battle in the...
The name's Rocket. Rocket Raccoon.
The High Evolutionary. And I think, if I recall correctly, he chose to spare his life. He didn't kill him. Dumb mistake, I'm sure. But leads to shows later on, probably. Following the battle, the other Guardians left the team, including Star-Lord. And I guess that's when he made Rocket the new leader of the Guardians of the Galaxy. And I think the new Guardians were Rocket, Raccoon, Groot, Abfonteri. That's the guy that got the whistle stick from Randu. The guy from The Walking Dead that played the drug addict. Let's see, who else? Cosmo. I think that's the dog from Sputnik. And Adam Warlock. He was in the third movie. I'm not sure who Phyla and Blurp are, but apparently they joined the Guardians of the Galaxy too. Now, I liked the movies. They weren't bad. The second one was a little weird, but the third one was actually really good and made up for the second one. I just don't pay attention to names and everything. I'm kind of half watching movies at the same time as doing other things most of the time. But I really dig the Guardians of the Galaxy. It's one of the better IPs out of the Marvel Cinematic Universe before they fell off after Endgame. And that's just another opinion from this panda. Take it or leave it.
Panda number four.
Panda Jujutsu Kaisen. Panda is a major supporting character in Jujutsu Kaisen and is one of the main protagonists in its prequel Jujutsu Kaisen Zero Jujutsu High. Despite his name, Panda is not actually a panda. There's a lot of that going on this list. He's an abrupt mutation cursed corpse. Damn, that's a mouthful. Created by... Now, this is Japanese, not Chinese, so this should be a little bit easier for me. Masamichi Yaga. He attended Jujutsu High as a second-year student along with Maki, Toge, and Yuta. Now, I've seen this show, but I'm not familiar with a lot of the names, but I do love Panda, of course. Panda has the appearance of a fully grown giant panda. He stands much taller than the rest of his classmates with his bear-shaped frame and sometimes even puts on some clothes. It looks a little silly, though. He's been shown to wear armbands, scarves, and jackets at times. What are you wearing, a jacket, cuz? You got fur. Panda is generally very upbeat and calm. He's a calm individual with his own sense of humor. When he was younger, he spoke in an extremely proper form, more akin to a computer. What does that mean? More akin to a computer. A computer sounds like this. What? He sounded like he was Mr. Roboto. That don't make no sense. But anyways, it says that he was more akin to a computer, but as time passed, Panda had developed his own unique personality. Along with being a major badass fighter with three different types of souls in his, what was it again? Abrupt mutation cursed corpse. Each one of these souls allows him to turn into a more formidable fighter than the last one. You got the base panda, you got the giant gorilla panda, and then you triceratops. I ain't seen that one yet. I might not be far enough into the series to have seen Triceratops Panda. But you can see Panda do his thing in both Season 1 and 2 of Jujutsu Kaisen and also in the OVA Jujutsu Kaisen Zero. Panda number 3. Sexual Harassment Panda.
Please welcome Petey, the Sexual Harassment Panda.
Who lives in the east beneath the willow tree? Sexual harassment panda. Who explains sexual harassment to you and me? Sexual harassment panda. Don't say that. Don't touch there. Don't be nasty, says the silly bear. He's gonna tell you what's right and wrong. Sexual harassment panda.
Sexual Harassment Panda is the sixth episode of the third season of the American animated television series South Park, and the 37th episode overall for the series. It originally aired on Comedy Central in the United States on July 7th, 1999. In the episode, a school presentation on sexual harassment prevention leads to Cartman suing Stan for sexual harassment.
Oh my God, seriously, who is sexual harassment me?
I don't know, man. I don't know if that's a good impersonation of Eric Cartman. I tried. Which in turn promotes a series of sexual harassment lawsuits across South Park. I remember that episode. That was stupid funny. Wasn't that the same one where they said the word molested?
Parents molested me. Oh my God, seriously, he molested me.
I probably gotta bleep that out. This was the first episode to air after the release of the theatrical film South Park, Bigger, Longer, and Uncut. According to the DVD commentary of the episode, Parker and Stone were so exhausted and hungover, it actually says hungover, and hungover from doing South Park the film, that they have no memory in making the episode of Sexual Harassment Panda. Ain't that some shit? Getting so wasted while making a film that you don't even remember making the episode that you made after the film. Yeah, but I like those guys. So, Panda lets it pass. like anybody gives a shit if I say it passes. I don't know. Maybe somebody? Somebody cares? Anybody? Whatever.
Panda number 2.
Genma Sao Tome. Genma Sao Tome is Ranma Sao Tome's father from the show Ranma One Half and the sensei of Sao Tome Dojo of the School of Indiscriminate Grappling, or more commonly known in the West as the Anything Goes School of Martial Arts. During the time when Genma took Ranma on a decade-long training voyage to improve their martial arts skills, he insisted on going to this spring in China. Let me try to pronounce this one. Jusinkyo. Jusinkyo. Yeah, that sounds like it looks right. A place he believed to be a training ground. Now, however, because of Genma's ignorance of the Chinese language, yes, he did not realize that the ground was unfrequented because it's cursed. Genma, all too late, realized his mistake that he made after his son kicked him into one of the cursed springs that training session. Genma was knocked into the... Hold on, let me see if I can pronounce this one. Shenmiaoyuan. Oh, man, it's even more. Xiomanyakwan. So, the spring of the drowned panda. Due to the nature of the Jusinkyo curse, a victim who falls into the spring is cursed to turn into who or whatever drowned there when doused with cold water. So that means whenever Genma is splashed with cold water, he becomes a giant panda. Jeez. What a crappy thing to have. Life as a panda ain't that great, y'all. Now, with hot water, it'll change him back into a human form. Despite the fact that he and his son were cursed, Genma still brought Ranma back to fulfill a marriage engagement in Japan with his longtime friend and fellow martial artist, Suintendo, the terms of which were as follows. Ranma would marry one of Suin's daughters and carry on the anything goes school of martial arts. How would that even work out? I could just hear the conversation now. Look, bruh. I know my son is a girl and I'm a giant panda, but yo, man, we got a contract and one of your girls has got to be wed to my son. You made the agreement, not me, right? And in today's society, he'd just say, what? What's the matter? You don't like my son being a girl? What are you, a bigot? Panda number one. And the number one panda on the top 10 list is, Mr. Producer, can I get a drum roll, please? Me, motherfuckers. It's my damn podcast. What? You think that I wouldn't have the hubris to put myself as the numero uno top G number one panda on the list? Pfft. Now, your boy Panda is a realist and understands many of these esteemed pandas on the top 10 list are masters of their respective martial arts and just straight up throwing hands brawlers into this. I say, you haven't seen my powers yet. Kung Fu is neat, but not from 100 feet.
I felt like putting a bullet between the eyes of every panda that wouldn't screw to save its species.
Escalated quickly. I mean, that really got out of hand fast.
It jumped up a notch.
It did, didn't it?
That's what I got for you this episode. If you'd like to show me some love, hit me with that HPO special. That's the Help a Panda Out special. Hit that like and subscribe button for more content. Until next time.
I just cashed out on a feature. Then cuz said he want a better verse. That reality is all augmented like y'all living in the metaverse. I'm authentic when I run a verse.